Thank you. We'll have time for questions about the first three topics after Dr. Shah presents. And our next speaker is Dr. Shah, who's speaking about low-grade non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. So welcome.
Thank you, Mike. Can everybody hear me well? Perfect. So, how many of you have seen lymphoma patients? Can you raise your hands, please? Perfect, so many people. How many of you have seen non-Hodgkin's lymphoma? Perfect, many people. So, lymphoma is common. That's why many of you have seen these patients. I'm going to talk about low-grade lymphomas, which is a group of non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. These are my conflict of interest disclosure, some stock ownership, and I'm on the speaker bureau of Teva Pharmaceutical. So, as you know, lymphoma is a malignant disease of lymphoid organs. And most of the lymphomas are of B-cell origin. However, you will have a small number of patients with lymphomas of T-cell origin or NK cell origin. Now, most of the B-cell lymphomas arise from germinal center or post-germinal center B-cells. That is mainly because germinal center is the site of initiation of transforming events. That is where cells undergo many DNA modifying events. And because of this process, there is a chance that errors would be introduced in the DNA sequence, and that would lead to lymphomagenesis. So broadly, there are two kinds of lymphomas. As you all know, there are Hodgkin's lymphomas and non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. Non-Hodgkin's lymphomas are the most common type of lymphomas. But non-Hodgkin's lymphomas are biologically and clinically heterogeneous group of diseases. As a matter of fact, there are more than 60 different kinds of non-Hodgkin's lymphomas. And it is a major challenge from diagnostic standpoint. Is Dr. Fulton here? Yes. Do you agree it is a big diagnostic challenge? Says our hematopathologists. Most of the non-Hodgkin's lymphomas are of B-cell origin. Now, the natural history, treatment, prognosis of the disease would depend on the specific subtype of lymphoma and the stage of the disease, of course. As you know, broadly, non-Hodgkin's lymphomas can be divided into two groups. You can have indolent lymphomas and aggressive lymphomas. Indolent lymphomas are slow growing, so this division is based on characteristics of disease at the time of presentation and the patient's expected life expectancy if the disease is left untreated. For example, if somebody has Burkitt's lymphoma, which is an aggressive kind of lymphoma, the expected survival would be a matter of weeks to months in the absence of treatment. However, if somebody has follicular lymphoma, the expected survival may be in years, depending on their clinical symptoms and stage of the disease. So I'm going to focus my talk on follicular lymphoma, which is the most common type of low-grade or indolent lymphoma. As you know, 20% of all lymphomas are follicular lymphomas, and they are derived from germinal center B cells. These cells, the tumor cells, are positive for CD20, CD10, BCL6, BCL2, and they are negative for CD5. Almost all the tumors, approximately 90% of them, are positive for translocation 14-18. Most of the patients present with painless lymphadenopathy, they would have a lymph node somewhere and they will receive antibiotic for a week or two by primary care providers, thinking it could be from infection. But because the lymph node would not go away, the patient would end up receiving biopsy, and that would give them diagnosis. you can have B symptoms. Patients may have fevers, night sweats. They may have unexplained weight loss. They may have fatigue. Some patients can have symptoms from organ involvement. For example, one of my patients I saw recently came with left upper extremity swelling, and that was because of massive lymphadenopathy in left supraclavicular area. Another patient of mine I recently saw presented with renal failure because of massive intra-abdominal lymphadenopathy that obstructed the ureters. And up to 70% of the patients have bone marrow involvement. So majority of the follicular lymphoma patients have advanced disease. Diagnosis would require incisional or excisional biopsy in most cases, immunophenotyping, flow cytometry, and sometimes cytogenetics or FISH is required for the to make a diagnosis. As you know, these cells are CD20 positive, CD10 positive, BCL6 positive, BCL2 positive, and CD5 negative. Now, you must always look at the grade of the lymphoma on the pathology report, because that will tell you the biology of the tumor. For example, grade 1 tumors, they grow slowly. Grade 3 tumors grow fast. As a matter of fact, even the treatment would depend on the grade of the tumor. Grade 3 tumors are treated as diffuse large B-cell lymphomas. So once you make a diagnosis, you have to do some staging and workup. There is no alternative to good history and comprehensive physical exam. You must check blood counts, complete metabolic panel, LDH. Beta 2 microglobulin is prognostic, so that can help you with the prognosis of the patient. CT scan of chest, abdomen, and pelvis, bone marrow aspiration and biopsy to document involvement of bone marrow involvement in patients. Again, pregnancy testing should be done in young women, and MAGAI scan should be done, or echocardiogram should be done, because many of these patients would end up receiving anthracycline-based chemotherapy. Now, the treatment of follicular lymphoma depends on the stage of the disease and clinical symptoms. Now, stage 1 and 2 diseases are primarily treated with involved field radiotherapy. In fact, this is the standard of care based on current NCCN guidelines. Immunochemotherapy, like R-CHOP, RCVP, rituximab, bendamustine, fludarabine-based treatment with rituximab are other options. Again, combined modality treatment with chemo and radiotherapy is another option. However, you would be surprised that the treatment recommendations are not based on prospective randomized controlled trials. It is amazing to see that follicular lymphoma is the most common indolent lymphoma, comprises 20% of all lymphomas, but you do not have prospective randomized controlled trial for localized follicular lymphoma. Radiotherapy has been shown to achieve 40 to 50% 10-year disease-free survival. Now, Dr. Advani from Chicago, she did some retrospective study, and she found that survival rates of these patients are the same for wait and watch group versus immediate treatment. In fact, this paper was published in JCO, and because of this paper, many guidelines introduced wait and watch as one of the options. Combined modality therapy has been found to provide superior disease control rates compared to previously reported rates with radiotherapy. We recently analyzed CR database, CR18 database. We included patients, adult patients, with stage 1 follicular lymphoma who were diagnosed from January of 1992 to December of 2006. This paper will be presented at ASH next month. So we had more than 5,000 patients, and we found that 1 and 5 year relative survival rates were significantly superior in patients who received radiotherapy compared to those who did not receive radiotherapy. And that was true in different cohorts, like younger patients or older patients, men and women. In fact, this paper has been accepted for publication. It should be out on PubMed in a few weeks. So if you look at NCCN guidelines, they recommend radiotherapy as the preferred treatment for localized follicular lymphoma. Again, immunochemotherapy, immunotherapy alone, combined modality therapy, wait and watch are other options. If you look at the studies, National Lymphocare Study, which was a large study that basically enrolled patients from over 200 sites in the United States, they found that only 27% of stage 1 follicular lymphoma patients receive radiotherapy. In our study, we found that only 37% of the patients nationally receive radiotherapy. So it is amazing to see that radiotherapy is the preferred treatment, but it is not being utilized widely. Why is that? Because we do not have a scientifically validated standard of care at this point. We do not have prospective randomized controlled trials at this point to support one treatment over other. So there is an urgent need to compare different treatment options, radiotherapy, combined modality therapy, immunochemotherapy, single agent immunotherapy, or wait and watch approach. There is a need to develop new biomarkers to see which patients would really require immediate treatment, because as Dr. Advani's study showed, many of these patients do not require treatment for long periods of time. So that's where we are with the localized follicular lymphoma. So again, at this point, treatment options would be radiotherapy, immunochemotherapy, immunotherapy alone, combined modality approach, wait and watch. I guess at this point, we have to talk to our patients, explaining to them about pros and cons of different approaches and help them make a diagnosis. Now, for a stage 3 or stage 4 disease, the treatment depends on the symptoms and the tumor burden. So if you have asymptomatic or low tumor burden follicular lymphoma, the options at this point are wait and watch or single agent rituximab. This paper, which was recently published a few months ago in Lancet Oncology, they compare rituximab with wait and watch approach. So what they did was included all these patients with advanced stage, asymptomatic, non-bulky follicular lymphoma, and randomized them to receive induction rituximab, which is once a week rituximab times 4, or maintenance rituximab. That would mean once a week rituximab times 4, followed by every 2 months rituximab for 2 years, and observation only. The primary endpoint was time to start of new therapy and the quality of life at the 7th month. So this was the schema. So as you see, they had approximately 500 patients who were randomized to receive induction rituximab, maintenance rituximab, or observation. And this was the finding. This is basically a comparison of a wait and watch group versus maintenance rituximab group. They found that time to start of new therapy was significantly better in patients who received maintenance rituximab. It does not surprise me. Does it surprise anybody? Again, progression-free survival was significantly better in patients who received maintenance rituximab compared to those who were observed. There was no difference in overall survival. There was no difference in time to histologic transformation. Now, these graphs compare all these three arms, and they found, again, induction rituximab was superior to wait and watch in terms of time to start of new therapy. However, and there was no difference between maintenance rituximab and induction rituximab in terms of time to start of new therapy. Similarly, as far as progression-free survival was concerned, rituximab induction was superior to wait and watch. However, maintenance rituximab was superior to rituximab induction therapy, but there was no difference in overall survival. There was no difference in time to histologic transformation in these groups. So, clearly, compared with observation, immunotherapy improves progression-free survival. It improves time to start of new therapy. Study also found that quality of life was superior in patients who received maintenance rituximab compared to observation arm. There was no difference in quality of life between the induction arm and observation arm. They also analyzed second primary malignancies, and they were comparable in all the groups. So this was the author's take. They say rituximab monotherapy is effective in delaying the progression and need of chemotherapy or radiotherapy in patients who have asymptomatic low tumor burden follicular lymphoma. And of course, quality of life is better in patients who receive maintenance treatment. Now, question is, 46% of the patients in observation arm did not require any therapy at 3 years. So are we over-treating some of these patients who may not require treatment for long periods of time? Now, the toxicities of rituximab, which is manageable compared to many other conventional chemotherapy, but still, some of the patients can have fatal toxicities. The cost of the treatment, does it justify the benefit? So these questions need to be answered. So as of now, treatment options are wait and watch and single agent rituximab. Again, the treatment decisions should be based on your conversation with the patients about pros and cons of different approaches. Now, symptomatic or high burden follicular lymphoma. So what are the options? It is primarily treated with chemotherapy, immunochemotherapy. So you have RCVP, R-CHOP, R-bendamustine, fludarabine-based treatment with rituximab, and radioimmunotherapy. Most commonly in the United States, it is R-CHOP that is used right now. The study analyzed bendamustine rituximab with R-CHOP. It was a randomized controlled trial, and it showed that bendamustine rituximab improved progression-free survival significantly compared to CHOP-R. So progression-free survival, median progression-free survival was approximately 70 months in bendamustine rituximab compared to 31 months in R-CHOP group. And the toxicity profile was favorable for BR chemo regimen compared to R-CHOP. So again, bendamustine rituximab is now more commonly used in advanced follicular lymphoma, where you have high tumor volume, where you have symptoms. Now for relapsed patients, radioimmunotherapy is approved. It should be used in patients who have adequate blood counts and who have less than 25% marrow involvement by lymphoma. Now this new molecule, idelalisib, that Dr. Venugopal talked about, it is again, it was recently approved for treatment of relapsed follicular lymphoma. It is a PI3K inhibitor. As you all know, PI3K plays a central role in B cell development and function. And PI3K delta is hyperactive in B cell neoplasms. And idelalisib is an inhibitor of PI3K. It is an oral pill, 150 milligram twice a day or so. So this study, which was published recently, a few months ago in New England Journal of Medicine, they looked at efficacy of idelalisib in relapsed indolent lymphoma. 125 patients they had, median age was 64 years. 58% of the patients had follicular lymphoma. And majority of the patients had a stage 3 or stage 4 disease. And the median number of treatments these patients had received was 4. It was interesting to see that some of these patients had received 12 regimens. How many of you have given 12 chemo regimens to follicular lymphoma patients? I have not. Have you, Dr. Venugopal? So,
I can't think of 12 regimens.
Exactly. It just amazes me, you know, what the oncologists give to these patients. And if you look at this, majority of the patients were refractory to all the commonly used treatments. Like 100% of them were refractory to rituximab. 99% of them were refractory to alkylating agents. And basically almost 75 to 90% of them were refractory to all the commonly used treatments. And this is the response. 90% of the patients responded, which is fantastic for this group of patients who did not have many options. So the tumor reduction was seen in 90% of the patients. If you look at our research criteria, the 6% of the patients had CR and 50% of the patients had PR. Median duration of response was slightly more than a year. 47% of the patients were progression-free at 4 years, which is fantastic by any standard in this set of group of patients. Common grade 3 or higher side effects were cytopenias, transaminitis, diarrhea, and pneumonia. So idelalisib was recently approved based on this data for treatment of relapsed follicular lymphoma. So future is, as you look at this list, targeted treatment. It is like in the past when you had a war between different countries, you would have hundreds of thousands of army men fighting with other people. But now, the war is more sophisticated. You know, you have drones and whatnot. You try to target your enemy. So this is exactly what we are trying to do now with cancers. We're trying to target actual cancer cells. We're trying to see the specific antigens, specific pathways that can be targeted to control the cancer. So this not only helps us improve survival, it helps us minimize the toxicities. And again, AVT-199, who is a BCL-2 inhibitor, it is an upcoming agent. We'll wait for some presentations at ASH to see what new data they have. So with this, I would like to conclude. Thank you.